All right. Hello, everybody. Hello, hello. Welcome on in to Thinkful's webinar, Intro to Data Analytics SQL Fundamentals. My name is Dodge McIntosh. I'll be leading us through our webinar session today. Today, we're going to cover a lot of ground. We're going to talk about what is SQL, or SQL, if you prefer. Talk about why it's an important tool in that data analytics toolkit and how to actually use it. We'll go over some SQL syntax introduction and some SQL practice. And for both of these pieces, throughout today's entire workshop, we're going to be actually getting our hands on some SQL queries. I really think that's the best way to learn. So I'm happy to say that that's how we'll be learning today, with some hands-on examples. At the end, we'll go over some additional resources. Hopefully, you're still interested in learning more about data analytics, more about SQL. I'll share some of my favorite ways to do that from around the web, as well as right here with us at Thinkful. So before we actually get into writing those SQL queries, I'd like to just take a second and position ourselves in this overall data ecosystem. Right? Talk about where the work that we're doing today fits into the work that everybody else does. And we're really seeing this boom in the data ecosystem and these specific data-driven roles like engineers, analysts, scientists, because of the amount of data that's being collected and the improved ways of being able to process that data, right? Improved hardware, improved programming techniques. And with all of those tons and tons of information, that data that a company collects, we really do need more of a collective or more of a collaborative way to work through it than ever before. Now, so let's talk about each of those positions in the data ecosystem. And they do work together, but they really do have distinct roles in how to create value out of that data. So we'll start over here with data engineers, masters of gathering and storing data. On a day-to-day basis, they're more focused at the point of data capture. And then once that data has been captured, they're also responsible for the efficient warehousing, storage, and structure of that data. Their work is going to make it possible for everyone else down the chain to do theirs. Once a company's collected that data, different stakeholders are going to request some information. They're going to want to know something about it. They'll have questions that they want answered. And when we talk about stakeholders, I mean corporate executives, board members, team managers, outside clients, anybody who has that kind of invested interest in this project. That data in a vacuum is kind of useless, though. So it's going to get passed to either data analysts or data scientists to work with it and generate some kind of value. Data analysts are the ones who translate those raw numbers into stories that help our stakeholders here make those better data-driven decisions. Companies and these stakeholders have all kinds of questions that they want answered. And data analysts are responsible for using any and all of that data that the company collects to be able to answer those questions. We also have data scientists over here, specializing in algorithms and predictive modeling. While they're also going to be pros at analyzing data in their own right, their larger focus is using that historical or using that collected data to make predictions about new or unseen instances. At smaller companies, data scientists will also often work across more than one of these roles and might even pick up some data engineering responsibilities. And that's kind of true in general when we're talking about the size of a data team or the size of a company, right? At much larger companies, each of these roles are going to be more distinctly developed. Each one has a little bit more isolation. When smaller to medium companies, these are going to start to blur together, right? Maybe if you're the principal data person at a very, very early stage startup, well, maybe you're ending up doing all three of these things together. For the purposes of our workshop today, we're going to focus more on the skill set that you need to be successful as a data analyst or as a data scientist. And one of the things that's going to translate across all of these different roles is SQL. But first, we'll start over here with statistics, right? Essential to your work as a data analyst is these statistics skills, including probability theory at a minimum. These concepts are going to help you make better data-driven decisions for your business, right? Other key concepts in this box are going to include probability distributions, understanding statistical significance, hypothesis testing, and regression. Moving right along, we have critical thinking, and this really is going to bleed into everything else that we do. Whether we're doing that initial data exploration, or we're creating some reporting dashboard and Tableau, or maybe we're answering questions after presenting the recommendations that we have, we have to be able to think through problems and possible solutions. So you want to make sure that you're taking your time, be deliberate, and that you give yourself permission to think clearly. Up next in our toolkit, we have presentation and communication. And this is one that gets kind of lost in the shuffle sometimes, so it's one that I always like to maybe overemphasize. But as a data analyst, you're not getting paid to just analyze the data in a vacuum, right? You get paid to analyze that data in order to uncover insights or those patterns, and then use those to make actual recommendations. So just as important as the analysis that you're conducting is how you can present those insights. And that's going to lead us into the art of presenting and storytelling with data. Moving right along, we have business intelligence tools. And there's a bunch of different apps and platforms that fall into this category. Some of the better known ones that you might have heard of are Tableau, SAS, Looker, and Google Data Studio, just to name a few. And although these tools have pretty big differences from one to the other, their basic purpose is going to be the same. They're going to allow you as a user to combine that data from different sources in order to create dashboards and other visual analytics pieces. They're going to help track the metrics that are driving your business strategy. We also have basic programming here. So many, if not most, entry-level data analyst jobs don't explicitly require those programming skills. But if you're going for a more senior position, you sometimes might. And then even as a junior data analyst, knowing how to program can give you a big leg up over other applicants. The two most common programming languages for data analysis are Python and R. If you haven't picked up either one, I recommend getting started with Python. And that's because as a data scientist, the vast majority of your workflow is going to be conducted in Python. So it's a great one to learn for data analytics, as well as if you want to continue on to data science. Using a programming language, you can conduct some more sophisticated statistical analysis. You could create high-quality custom visualizations. You could interact with data APIs as part of your data collection. You could scrape websites for that data collection. Or maybe you just want to create some Python scripts that'll automate any of the more repetitive tasks that you have. Right? That basic programming comes in handy all over the place. And then finally, data analysts and data scientists both need to be masters of structured query language, or SQL, or pronounced SQL. SQL is a language that allows you to interface with relational databases. And those are still the most common type of database used to store data in the business world today. SQL is obviously what we'll be focused on during our workshop, including what relational databases are and how to use SQL to access and analyze them. So you've heard me use this term a couple different ways. Some people pronounce it SQL, like those independent letters, or like the word SQL. And this is usually how you'll hear it. That's how I use it as well. So SQL stands for Structured Query Language, and it's the language that was written to be able to communicate with databases to store, manage, and analyze your data. So why should you learn SQL? Why does it matter? Well, apart from maybe being a job requirement for positions that you started to look at, SQL is really important to learn because it's the only language that we can use to understand databases. Right? Other software that's out there like Excel or some programming languages, they're not actually configured to talk to databases per se. Because of the advent of new ways to store data, for example, you might have heard of non-relational databases or NoSQL databases. There are some other languages that you might need to learn to access your data, but there's tons of similarities in learning how to do that. So your time learning SQL is not going to be wasted. I also like to take this quick time and just talk about who uses SQL, just to illustrate really how far-reaching and how widely used SQL still is. So pretty much all data analysts work with at least some SQL. And that's because pretty much all businesses use databases to store and manage data. Relational databases are the most common ways to store that data, and you need SQL to access those. So we'll cover the concept of exactly what relational database means in greater depth later. But for now, when we use that term relational, just understand that it's a database where relationships between those data points matter. Maybe we have a table with customers and a second table with orders, and each order points to a customer whose info is stored in that customer table. Right? The relationships between those entries matter. And like I was saying, because all businesses store data, this includes companies, you know, from huge Fortune 500 ones, medium, smaller companies, small businesses, online stores, really across the board. And SQL is used for a bunch of different applications too. Used for data analytics, data science, web development, app development, really all over the place. We've also got some companies over here that use SQL. Our first one here, Stripe, right? Maybe the finance industry if we're talking about. So Stripe stores data in a relational database, uses SQL to aggregate data about financial transactions and about those users. We've also got a couple of music application ones up here on the screen. Both Spotify and Pandora store libraries of music files and albums by artists in a relational database. So they'll also use data based on the previous listens to find what types of songs that user's looking for. They'll store that information in a relational database and use SQL to store, manage, and access that data. Our last example, social media platforms like Instagram here. Instagram will store a user's profile information, biography, location, all in a relational database. They'll also use SQL to record new posts, store messages sent, and then use SQL again to analyze those different trends that they found, or to help companies identify patterns in that customer behavior. So really, across the board, from industry to company size to application, SQL is a tremendously helpful tool to have in your toolkit. And one final note here, while we're kind of talking about our SQL overview, as I just want to talk a little bit about these different systems, these different database systems that companies will use. So these ones are programs that allow you to work with that database using some kind of user interface, right? So we have ones like Oracle DB. It's pretty popular with online transaction processing. We also have MySQL, which is free and pretty popular with small businesses. There's Microsoft SQL Server, which is Windows-based, so it's good for Windows-based teams. And then we also have PostgreSQL. This one's growing in popularity. It's free and it's still popular with tech startups, but starting to see it pop up a little bit more just beyond that scope. The actual program or the actual software that your team is going to use, that actual system, is going to be pretty variable from team to team. And there are syntax differences between each of these. You know, maybe the way that MySQL handles strings or text is different from the way that Postgres does. Well, as long as you have the core concept under your belt, well, it's going to be easy to translate between each of those. Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us on this Thinkful webinar. Hopefully, you've already learned some great information already. If you do want to see the rest of this session, just click the link right here in the video or down below in the description. Don't forget to like and subscribe to our channel, and hopefully we'll see you again real soon.